Thanks for having me as your keynote speaker. And we'll talk about Marxism today and what that is and how it relates to sociology. You may have seen things like Occupy Wall Street. They've had Occupy Dallas, which is, you wonder what these people are protesting about. They seem exploited. They seem, they can't make the system work for them. You may have seen factories, Bangladesh factories, that are collapsing and killing poorly paid workers there. And are these kind of examples just a unique situation? Are they caused by the individuals themselves? Did they not climb the ladder adequately, so they're stuck in these poor things? Or is there something about the structure that's causing these kind of problems today? Well, maybe Marxism will help us see some causes of problems that are happening today. So let me talk a little bit about Marx and what he saw. He was living during the 19th century, born 1818, died in 1883. He lived in mainly Europe. He was born in Germany. He ended up in England and pretty much stayed there. He ended up there because he kept getting kicked out of other countries because he was a journalist, kind of an inflammatory journalist. He critiqued society and governments a lot, so he was getting kicked out of places like Germany and France and Belgium. He eventually married a socialite, an aristocrat, and had seven children. He lived in poverty and was supported both academically and financially by his friend Friedrich Engels, who co-authored a lot of his works. So what is Marxism? It's the way he was looking at society and his analysis of it. He is using history and looking at how material production actually affects our lives. And Marx emphasized class struggle. Classes mean groups of people that you can't really escape easily from. Like a class of people can be rich and poor, or male, female, black, white, those kind of groups. So Marx was focusing on the classes that were stakeholders in the industrial age. He saw these factories that I talked about earlier that were producing things, yet these workers were pretty exploited in the sense that they weren't paid that much, safety conditions were poor, their lives were somewhat dysfunctional, and there was this other class, the upper class, meaning the owners of these factories, and they controlled the system. They were the only place, these factories, that you can make money, and this was a system of capitalism that you needed money to get food and things to live on. So these two classes Marx called bourgeoisie and proletariat, and if you use that word, try to learn how to spell it, then you can impress your friends and gain prestige. So the bourgeoisie means the owners of these factories, the owners of the means of production, and the proletariat are the workers. So those were the two main classes that Marx was looking at. The Those two classes represent this class struggle, this competition between the two classes. And this is the key to Marxism, is class struggle. He says, I'll translate for you, the history of all previous society is the history of class struggle. So basically saying that all of these struggles and the history of people have come down to struggle between classes, class conflict. Let's talk about how society basically runs first that causes this conflict. And that's called the mode of production. How we make things determines everything else. Like how we make food, how we grow stuff, how we allocate it and distribute it affects everything else. All culture, all institutions, and changes, you know, all of that. So we'll call that the base. The base is the way we make stuff, the mode of production. And the base will affect the superstructure, meaning the culture and all the ways we relate to each other. There have been different modes of production throughout history. So we can say maybe the first mode of production was the hunter-gatherer society, that tribes, families would hunt, gather, produce, grow stuff for themselves. The technology was not very advanced, so that they didn't make a whole lot. They got enough stuff just to make it through the day, make it through the week, and then they had to, you know, start over again. So no surplus was accumulated. As we increased our technology and ways of doing things, groups and classes did start getting a surplus of stuff, and that's where inequality starts. Some of the other previous modes of production were, you know, like Asiatic, meaning to just go around and steal and pillage from other societies, or the slave mode of production, meaning to enslave other groups of people to, you know, to produce your own resources. The feudalist mode of production was all about living on the land of some aristocrat's landlord's land and growing your own food. Now, why would the aristocrat allow you to do this? Well, they would take a percentage, a cut of what you would grow. You would grow your own food, you would probably live there, and you would give some in return as rent to the owner. So that was the feudal mode of production. There was an understanding in society of how this worked, and that's what people did, and people on the land, they had to work, they had to grow their own food, and they did it with their families. Everyone was working together, and they represented a class too. The peasants, they didn't own land. So that means the owners of the land were of another class, and they had some of this power to create this system. The next mode of production after feudalism was capitalism, and I'll go into these in more detail in a minute. The capitalist mode of production came about through, you know, advances in technology and rationality and education, all that. And that features, you know, certain characteristics like the free market, private ownership, mainly of factories, competition among, you know, those that want to come in and buy and sell stuff to the market, and this profit motive that anything you make, you can keep. So the game was won by if you can accumulate enough profits, you know, to have more than other people. The more you have, the more advantaged you are. You can stay on top of things. You can actually create the system that would advantage you. And we will then see how this converts into another mode of production called socialism. And that will be the public ownership of things like factories and things to produce stuff for society. And a key thing here is central planning. Society needs to plan for everyone's needs and make sure everyone has a fair shot at surviving. So there's not this competition we find in capitalism. Now, each mode of production has its peculiar relations of production. What are relations? Well, how do you relate to the system? During feudalism, you related in certain ways. You know, you got to live on the land, you had to work, your family was there working with you, you grew stuff, you gave some to the owner, the landlord, and that's how you lived. Now, under capitalism, that changed. You related to society differently. You were on your own, basically. You had to use money to buy things. You could not grow it yourself practically. You would need to get a job, work, trade your labor for money, and use money to buy stuff. And your labor actually was transformed into money. It was quantified. So how does this work? Well, Marx had this labor theory of value, meaning how is value created? How do you get more stuff out of nothing? Well, it's all by labor. By working and making stuff, or picking it or growing it, you are creating value, but you need to put labor into it, and the resulting product is valuable. It has value to it. A product's value is worth exactly with how much labor you put into that. So how does the capitalist or someone that wants to accumulate use this concept? Labor is put into products by workers, and workers will, you know, have that product, and it's worth more. But how does the owner of the factories actually get that value? Well, the owners will pay the workers maybe not enough of what that product is worth. The owners will sell the product for a lot more than the workers get paid. And that's where the difference comes in. That's where the profit is accumulated, by selling something for more than they paid to make it. Well, that's no, you know, big new thing, right? But why would the workers, you know, put up with that? Well, there was no other way to get money, basically. It's like take it or leave it. And if you don't want to work, there's a whole bunch of other workers that'll come in and work for you. There was what's called a false consciousness, meaning, you know, it was supposedly the norm to do this kind of work and to not complain, and maybe you can climb the ladder eventually. Maybe you can you know, make enough money so eventually you can be someone, an owner. So that's hiding these true relations between classes. You know, in reality, according to Marx, there's this upper class and lower class, and the upper class is really appropriating labor from the workers. Yet, you know, the upper class wants to say to the worker, there is no two classes, there is no exploitation, there is, we're all the same, and you're just you just happen to be down there, and we are up there, and maybe you can climb the ladder yourself. There's something that happens to money, too, when this occurs. When you're trading your labor for money, that money takes on this magical property. It becomes everything. And Marx said, you know, money can do everything, anything for you. So when that has that power, you know, it takes on this kind of magical, mystical quality. And that's called commodity fetishism. That means money or commodities or, you know, things of value take on this different kind of value. Originally, what was value? It was labor, right? The worker's labor somehow turns into money and then becomes this magical thing. And you think this magical thing, money, is great because it can make you do, you know, make things happen for you. Whereas in reality, according to Marx, you're really messing with people's labor. Someone labored hard and it was appropriated by the owners of the factories, and somehow now you have it and you don't realize what went into making that money. What made that money was this struggle, this appropriation of labor, this exploitation, if you want to call it that. So it like sterilizes that struggle. So it's hiding those class relations, really. Remember, because the owners had control of the system and could make the workers work for less than what they were worth, there was that class struggle. So money sterilizes that. You don't even see that anymore. And it allows it to continue. There is this alienation that occurs. You know, I think we've covered that before. You know, the worker has made this product. And in Marx's day, you know, that was the time that there used to be artisans and craftsmen. They would make stuff that was really nice, and they took pride in what they made. And now, you know, either it was taken away from them, or they're alienated from their product, or, you know, now maybe they make a small piece of it and they don't even see the whole product. So the process of making it is taken away from them. They're not involved in the whole process. It's real frustrating if you're just putting in a few, you know, bolts in something and you don't see the finished product. You're also alienated from people like your family. In the feudalist days, you worked with your family. Now you have to go away to work, and you know, you are isolated. You cannot really socialize. You're supposed to just do work, and also you're not self-actualizing. You know, you're not being what you really want or meant to be. You're just being molded into a factory worker, and you can't really do what you want or what you think you should be doing. So that's this these problems that Marx saw that the worker had because of this system. There's this interesting thing called how money and commodities are transformed. Normally, you know, when you want to get something, say you're hungry and you need to buy it, well, you need to go to work and make something and, you know, make a commodity. A commodity just means a product that you've made to trade for money. Then you get your money and you use that money to buy another commodity, like food. So that's, say, the traditional way to do things. Under this new system now, because money has taken on this magical quality, That is everything. That is the goal now, is to get money. It's not mainly, it's not the commodity anymore. It's really the money. So those with money, you can call them the capitalists, actually reverse this process of commodity, money, commodity. And that's what that CMC stood for. And I should put that next to proletariat. So the proletariat, the worker, started with making a commodity, traded it for money, and bought commodity with it. End of story. Now, the capitalists, intending to make money, make more money, start with money, because they have money. That's kind of the unfair part about this, is that, you know, the workers don't have money to start out with and create the system and participate. When you do have the money originally, you will use that and trade it for a commodity, not because you want to consume the commodity, but because you want to sell it and make more money. So you're reversing this process. Marx puts this prime indicator, meaning it's worth more money. So that's the goal of the capitalist, is to start with money, trade it, and make more money. And that's part of this commodity fetishism too. It's you know, this goal of money, because money is magical. It represents, you know, power, and you can do anything with it. Okay, so that was the how people related to the system under capitalism. So different classes relate to the system differently. You know, which end of the stick are you going to get? Under socialism, the goal is to be fair to everyone, to put emphasis on the collective. The collective is more important than the individual. And there will be no classes. There won't be this exploitation of upper class and lower class. There will just be one, you could say, middle class. And without this middleman or the capitalists appropriating and accumulating profit, there should be a bigger slice of the pie available to workers. You know, without these other owners just taking out all the profit, and you're left with little. So there should be a better life on average for most people. Everyone still has to work. You know, you still need to eat and make stuff, and you know, you can't get out of that. So in either system, everyone has to work. But you should really do real work, because value is created from labor, not from just trading money and commodities. When you're trading that, you're not creating, you're just appropriating, quote, stealing from other people so that you have more. So really, labor is something everyone should do, and not go around the system and just start trading, using money to make more money. Because that is unfair if you have, if you're starting out with more money. You have that power to make money from money, and not everyone can do that. So let's see how these different modes are transformed. How do they change, and why do they change? Technology and education have a lot to do with this kind of thing. You know, as we get more technologically advanced, we can travel and migrate and make stuff and figure out how to control things. So during this transformation from feudalism to capitalism, you know, that started out probably from, you know, technology allowing factories to produce stuff more efficiently, and, you know, greater development of populations and cities where there were enough workers in there to do those kind of things. So instead of the peasants working under the landlords, we have the factory workers working under the owners of the factories. All societies will change for some reason. And this is due to this process he calls dialectical materialism. That's a big word, but it's easy to understand. Dialectical just means there is a concept, or there's a way that society is running called maybe a thesis. This just means, okay, we're in society, we're running normally, and everything's going just fine. But ultimately, inevitably, an antithesis or antithesis starts building. Under capitalism, we had this growing frustration among workers. They were getting more pissed off. They were, you know, being exploited. They were suffering. They had problems. So that system was not going to be stable. You have this antithesis growing. So what happens is that every society will ultimately basically explode and produce a synthesis. This synthesis is the new society after this, you know, resolution of these internal conflicts play out. Then the synthesis becomes the thesis again, the norm, and it supposedly will happen again. So he thought that, you know, capitalism had this growing internal contradictions coming about, because, you know, how long can you sustain that kind of system where workers aren't really advancing, they're getting more frustrated and pissed off. And he also had some other theories of why capitalism would fail. Things like the falling rate of profit. If workers aren't getting paid that much, they won't be able to buy commodities and the prices will drop. Things like that. So that was one of his explanations for these transformations. Nothing stays the same. There's always going to be these internal contradictions building and causing eventual problems. So, any questions so far? Yeah, actually, it reminds me, I didn't talk about the materialism part, but this is the dialectical explanation for change. Now, how does materialism, you know, what does that mean? Well, that change is because everything is based on material production. Meaning, what I said before, you know, the base of society affects the superstructure, meaning, you know, all the relations that go into a society. And since our base is all about making stuff and allocating stuff, you know, how do we make it? How do we distribute it? This process is all affected by that material production, which was different than what some scholars in his days thought was important. Some other scholars thought that ideas and humankind and philosophy, certain philosophies, were really involved in this kind of process. But Marx said, no, it's just how do you find food? You know, that basically governs everything. So, you know, instead of this this esoteric academic that was thinking about all these kind of, you know, mystical ideas, he was saying, no, it's just how you make stuff. That's what causes all these problems. So that's dialectical materialism. So you can use that term, you know, at your next party. Dialectical just means there's always this change because there's these internal contradictions growing, and it's all because of how we make stuff. All right, so where does that leave us? So Marx had this theory that this change from capitalism to socialism, and why would there be this change? Well, there's these growing frustration, you know, the falling rate of profit, and those kind of problems. There would be this change to, you know, socialism through a revolution. You can't always just write about things and wish it would change. And he thought workers would actually have to use force to somehow change things. It was not enough to just think about it or wish it away. So Marx was not real clear or specific about how a revolution would actually occur. It sounded, you know, violent. Yet he never experienced any revolution like the one he was thinking of, you know, himself. So the first, you know, revolution that really happened was after his time, with Stalin, Lenin. So what would happen when this revolution came? Well, you know, we need to get rid of this system of exploitation. We can't allow people with money to control the system. We need a fair system. We need to make sure all big producing factories are collectively owned. Otherwise, you know, if some individual owns it, they are going to take advantage of the system. So there needs to be this transformation, which is going to be difficult. So you do need some interim leaders to manage that process, which is dangerous because they may just stay in power and abuse the system. It's important that capitalism will have created these factories and things, though. It's unlikely that a purely socialist system all along will have created this technology, because it takes appropriation and accumulation of profit possibly to make these kind of factories. And we need to be efficient and productive, so we need capitalism's outcomes actually to go into socialism. So he's saying you really need to go through capitalism before you get to socialism. What does that say about socialism? Well, you know, socialism isn't going to be as productive as capitalism, but it's more fair. So maybe you have an easier life, but you won't have as much. So now, when we get into a complete socialist economy, we're getting into what's called communism. And what is communism? Well, it's a complete socialist economy. The word socialism means, you know, the economic way of distribution, of allocation. But communism means an ideology, a political party, a will, a motivator. So you do need this structure of garnering people to move in a certain direction. So you need that, what I call flag waving. We need to say, you know, let's go team, let's all work, get up and work today, especially if there's not going to be a paycheck involved. Why is a paycheck dangerous? Well, that's, first of all, it's still keeping that money commodity fetishism around. You know, if we keep thinking money is so magical, we will start accumulating it, and we will hide the, you know, the exploitative class relations from before. And you will get what you need anyway. You will get your commodities. We will all be one big happy family. You do your work, you will get your commodities, and you know, life goes on as usual. So there needs to be this motivation to actually do that and guide this process. So we do need this communist flag waving and to get you through things. What people think communism is now is what they've seen in the Soviet Union and North Korea and China, and that's really a totalitarianism. That's where communism gets messed up with abusive leaders, and that's not what Marx expected or wanted. Marx wanted, all he wanted was a better life for the individual. And it's all about the advancement of the individual through collective work. You can say, well, isn't that really the collective? Well, maybe the only way to achieve individual freedom for everyone is to all be the collective, all be on the same page, rather than a few accumulating more than others and causing this exploitation. So this totalitarianism that occurs, meaning this extreme control of the individual, you know, holding a gun to your head, is probably came about because the system wasn't working well enough. People were starving, so you know, we had to work harder and work more and get on with the system, and you know, maybe everyone wasn't on board with this new kind of system. So that's what happened in all these other revolutionary changes. And these other societies that went through it really didn't go through advanced capitalism. You know, they didn't have pissed off workers that were really wanting to revolt. A lot of these places had, you know, just peasants that maybe weren't aware as much and didn't have the will to really make it through that new system. So you can say the Marxist revolution really never happened according to the way he saw it. We've never seen an advanced capitalist society revolt and go into this socialist mode. So what's the outcome of this communist, let's say, utopia? You know, freedom for the individual, and you can see the you can hunt in the morning and fish in the afternoon and reel cattle in the evening and all those kind of things. You know, is that really possible? You may have to live with less, you know, if we're not working hard 10 hours a day. Of course, we're not going to produce as much. On the other hand, there is no middleman taking away a lot of the profits, so maybe you can recoup some of that. So any questions so far on really what socialism and communism is? So do you know the difference between socialism and communism? What's the big key here? Ownership? Think flag waving. You know, you need that go team component there to guide and to motivate and get you through the process, that transformation. Marx did think, you know, once we got into this communist mode, you know, everyone would be on board Everyone's happy. We wouldn't even need government anymore because there's no, you know, exploitation. There's no problems between classes. Remember, the history of societies, you know, is the history of class struggle. So, you know, without the class struggles, you know, life would be better. We wouldn't need money. You know, everyone just does their part, and the food will be supplied to them. So, how come that didn't happen? Well, maybe Marx was wrong. Maybe capitalism was ingenious as far as its evolution. It kind of fills in, takes care of small problems that starts growing. Maybe it has paid workers more. And maybe it had to evolve into a better, kinder capitalism so that there wouldn't be revolution. So just pay workers just enough more to prevent them from revolting. Maybe make more of a middle class or where everyone's comfortable enough that they don't want to lose, you know, what they have. Also, you know, and we've never seen the frustration among workers in a capitalist society to that extent. We've seen some strikes and riots and things like that, but just not enough to push it past the breaking point. Now, can this occur with communism? You know, since every explosion of into synthesis, you know, turns into the thesis again, what could happen with communism? Nothing. Everyone stays quiet. You know, there could be another internal contradiction. There could be some growing frustration. I don't know. How could people be frustrated with communism?
I mean, they could feel like they're working harder than other people, not being recognized for their efforts.
Yeah. Yeah, that lack of incentive, maybe. You know, why should I work? Or maybe, you know, it's too easy to slough off and because...
Well, it's like you said about, like, you know, becoming a doctor. You can be the best you can for society. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, I did all this to become a doctor, and I'm helping out society this much, and the wood chipper down the road, you know, even that's the best he can do. Mm-hmm. He's not necessarily, you know, in the same level as I am, so I should get more than him now. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we're both doing valid services for, you know, the community. I'm helping people, you know, not be sick. He's clearing, you know, wood lines and stuff like that for expansion of housing, and essentially I believe I'm doing more than he is, so I should get more than he does.
Yeah, yeah.
And the same thing what people would want to say, like trying to change a capitalist society over to socialist, is that you're going to have to change a lot of people's minds. They've all been raised certain ways, and they all value different things, and then what if you do have that society, but then somebody gets a taste of, oh, this is what happens when you get to take advantage, oh, I don't have to work as hard, and then it might just go back down the ladder or back up or just transition back to a different society. Just because you're going to have different people with different opinions and who want to do things different ways. And
yeah, and a lot of sociological theory kind of explains those kind of things. You know, especially the first of all, with the indoctrination, you've grown up in a culture to know, you know, you do things a certain way. You know, you can't just change that overnight. You know, there's going to be relative deprivation, there's going to be, you know, competition and prestige, and some people say human qualities, like greed and all that, but, you know, a lot of those things can be taught or taught away. So yeah, communism can get into this, and, you know, a new synthesis coming about, maybe back into capitalism or something like that. It probably can't go back to feudalism or Asiatic or slave modes because, you know, we've got the technology now to do things certain ways. Can there be overlapping modes? Can we please everyone? like socialism and capitalism. What else? Do we have overlapping modes right now? Yeah, you know, we have aspects of socialism, you know, in our society, because I guess enough of the collective, you know, does, you know, enough people care about the collective, or people falling through the cracks, or, you know, we don't want real bad things happening to people, so will provide, you know, safety nets and welfare and methods of health insurance, those kind of things. So, you know, there can be this kind of overlap. Now, you know, it's always going to be competing, and sometimes there is this situation where there's an equilibrium created, and we almost want it to go one way or another, but it doesn't really have to. You know, say we have, you know, capitalism and socialism kind of competing in the U.S., you know, liberals and conservatives, whatever you want to call it, and, you know, is it okay to have that tension there just to maintain our equilibrium? I don't know. Okay is the right word, because that's a value judgment, but yeah, that doesn't have to go away. It's not necessarily going to win out one way or another. This equilibrium, this tension might be, you know, necessary in a society. So maybe that's an alternative. Can this idea give you ideas for your blood on your backs paper? This was the, you know, the Bangladesh factory workers, and we're buying those shirts for cheap. You know, what if Marx had to do that paper? What would he write? Yeah, and mm-hmm. And what should they do about it? What's Marx's solution to this exploited workers?
How the factories do more of a collectively owned thing instead of just a certain person or a certain.
Yeah, but how do you get to that point? I mean, that's the big thing you're struggling with on those papers, right?
Revolution.
Yeah, I mean, Marx would say revolution, violent revolution by the workers. And maybe this comes closer to his preconditions. They were, you know, it's capitalism, it's factory workers, they're not peasants. You know, maybe you don't want violent revolution, maybe you think it's too messy, or it might hurt people. But just, you know, what's Marx thinking? And, you know, what was his days like? I mean, you don't have to do this yourself, but think of what Marx might do. So that's another alternative to your paper, right? Using Marx's ideas, which, you know, you probably don't want. But, you know, is there any other change? Any other theories that you could apply to these Bangladesh factories that would, you know, change the system? You know, maybe no better ones. So, any other comments on that? What else would Marx say about the Bangladesh factories? Can you see the cheap shirts and the money savings you get hiding the class relations over there. So you see in Bangladesh or these or any factory areas, you can see the class relations pretty extreme. You know, the lower class, the working class, gets very little. They interface with society a lot differently than the owners of the factory. But we don't have to see that because their labor that created value in those shirts that we buy is all sterilized, you know, through money and commodities and all that. So we don't see all that. So things would be different if you had someone in front of you making a shirt for you, right? I mean, it would have meaning. You know, you would care about the worker, maybe. You would... Mm-hmm. Yeah. But so when you hide all that with money, then it's all, you know, exploitation is okay. You know, you don't care about what their condition is. So what else do you need to know? This will be on a question on the final, an optional question. You know, what is Marxism? And, you know, if you could summarize it in a, you know, a long, big paragraph, you know, that would be great. You know, it's basically a perspective on how the history of society has worked, these different modes of production. You know, it all comes down to social class and making stuff. It's pretty simple, right? It's not these real abstract theories about things. It's all about just down and dirty material stuff. Okay, what else shall I talk about? This is not going to be a good video. It's too stiff. I mean, there's so much to talk about. I mean, you can take classes in Marxism under different, you know, almost every PowerPoint slide you could take a different class in. There's so much to it. And Marx wrote thousands and thousands of pages on these things. A lot of it we don't believe right now. You know, a lot of it is faulty, but a lot of it is good. And he was also the first one to question these kind of things. And also the first one to scientifically, quote, you know, quantify actually what is it about class conflict. You know, how can you prove that there is true class conflict? Well, he was the first one to kind of do it. Before it was just whining, maybe it's people's fault, but now he sees it's the structure and he's actually, you know, proving it in a lot of his writings. So is this different than society's typical take on Marx? Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's still not working the way Marx wanted, but somehow Marx's influence is so big on these groups and leaders and revolutionaries that they are just using him kind of as a brand name. It's branding.
Mm-hmm. Because if you think about like what I would say an ideal family unit, you have everybody working together. Yes, you'll have the parents that are in charge, but they're working together. They're a team. Kids end up growing up, and then you get an adult relationship with everyone, and they're all friends. But it's a team, and you're kind of tied by living together or blood or whatever holds you together. You can call it stuff for a family, and just society caring about each other.
Yeah, so that's a good idea, right? I mean, so we should all be Marxists, and go out there and hold up some signs, and people will understand, right? So, just know that difference. I mean, that's such a misconception that society has with what Marx really is about. Now, maybe there will be no true Marxist revolution and the change to that. Maybe it's impossible. I don't know. But it does seem to explain a lot.